بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد سيد الأولين والآخرين وعلى جميع إخوانه من النبيين والمرسلين وآل كل وصحب كل ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. All praise is due to Allah, and may Allah raise the rank of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and protect his nation from that which he fears for them. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, let us first have the proper intention in our hearts to attend the lesson for the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. This ayah, as Abdullah ibn Mas'ud mentioned, is very, very inclusive. Although it's like one line, but it is very inclusive. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيْتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ وَالْبَغِي. This ayah contains three orders and three prohibitions. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيْتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ وَالْبَغِي. The three orders are al-adl, al-ihsan, and إِيْتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى. وَيَنْهَى, those are the prohibitions, عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ وَالْبَغِي. When one acquires the knowledge about religion, one can differentiate between the orders and the prohibitions. Otherwise, the one who does not acquire sufficient knowledge about religion, how is it expected from such a person to be able to differentiate between the order and the prohibition? There are people, out of ignorance, leave some orders thinking that they are prohibitions, or committing some prohibitions thinking they are orders, and vice versa. Things like this could happen out of ignorance. So the one who is not knowledgeable Islamically will be confused, will get mixed up between the orders and the prohibitions. This ayah is very inclusive. It tells us about three orders and three prohibitions. If we practice in accordance with this ayah, we'll be in a better situation, way better than what we are now. Let's start with the first order. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ. What's al-adl? Justice. Allah orders with justice, to be just. And to be just means to give the rights you owe to others. There are rights that you owe to Allah Azza wa Jal, and there are rights that you owe to the slaves of Allah Azza wa Jal. The greatest rights are those that you owe to Allah Azza wa Jal. And the greatest right upon the slave towards his Lord is for one to worship Allah alone without associating partner with him. That's the greatest right. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that in the hadith, that the greatest right of Allah upon the slave is for the slave to worship Allah alone and not to associate partners with him. That's the greatest right. Meaning to avoid blasphemy, to avoid committing shirk, which is a type of blasphemy, and other types of blasphemy. If one avoids blasphemy, then he has fulfilled this greatest right he owes to Allah Azza wa Jal. To believe in Allah, the proper belief. To worship Allah Azza wa Jal as you are ordered. To believe in Allah without likening Allah to the creations, without ascribing to Allah the attributes of the creations. So if one has the correct belief in Allah Azza wa Jal and he is worshipping Allah Azza wa Jal, then he is fulfilling this greatest right upon him from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also the rights you owe to the slaves. What are the rights you owe to the slaves? The rights you owe to the slaves, to give them the rights in full. So you do not deceive Muslims, you do not treat them unjustly, you do not take their belongings unjustly, you do not oppress them. This is all included in being just to Muslims. If you hire someone to do something for you for a certain amount of money, so upon fulfilling this task, he's entitled for this amount of money. When he performs this task for you fully, he is entitled to that amount of money you agreed on. So it's from al-adl, justice, to give him his right in full. That's from al-adl. If you don't give him his right in full, meaning you are unjust to him. So under injustice, many things can be included. When one is dealing with his wife, she has rights. He has to give her rights in full. If he's not giving the rights of his wife that he owes her, then he is unjust. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said once, كَفَى بِالْمَرْءِ إِثْمًا أَن يُضَيِّعَ مَن يَعُولُ. In another narration, مَن يَقُوت. For instance, there is obligatory sustenance that he has to provide his wife with. So if he doesn't provide his wife with the obligatory sustenance, he's missing out this right that she's entitled to. That means he is unjust to her. He is unjust to her, and that's a major sin. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Kafa bil mar'i isman." So if he doesn't have any other sin except for that one, that would be sufficient for such a person to deserve to be tortured in the hereafter. So your wife has rights upon you, your parents have rights upon you. So if you are not giving your parents the rights, you are unjust to your parents. Some children these days, when dealing with their parents, they don't deal with them with respect. Rather, a girl might scream in her mom's face because she wants such and such. And if her mom doesn't bring her what she wants, she comes back home and she's angry and she starts screaming at her mom. وَلَعِيَذُ بِاللَّهِ. As if her mother has become a slave for her. They don't treat their parents as they should. When in fact, the way you should treat your parents is like how you treat a king and a queen. Imagine you are in the presence of a king and a queen. What would you do? To what extent you show respect? This is how you should deal with your parents. The scholars mention that if your mother says to you, says to her daughter, for instance, come and help me in cleaning the dishes, in cleaning the floor, and the like, the house chores, and the daughter refuses to offer that help, as many would do these days, and that breaks the heart of the mother, because the mother might be tired all day, shopping, cooking, and the like. So at the end of the day, she needs that support and help from her daughter. If she requests of her daughter to help her in the house chores and she refuses, if that breaks the heart of the mother, then it is a major sin for the daughter to refuse to help her mother. The scholar said that if you, as a son, you want to go for a holiday with some friends, your mother is not feeling comfortable about it, and she says to you, I don't want you to go. My heart is not feeling comfortable towards this. I don't want you to go. If you insist and you go, and you leave your mom burning about your situation, what's going to happen to you, that's haram as well. There are rights that if you do not learn, how would you be able to know, yeah, this is an obligation? Because some daughters these days, they think, no, it's not my duty, that's mom's duty. She has to clean, she has to cook, she has to do such and such. All what I do is I eat, I throw my clothes in the basket, in the laundry. She will wash them later, my mom. They haven't learned about the obligations. So if one is unaware of the obligations, how would he be sure that he's fulfilling all the obligations? So I'm still with one word. I can give lessons about just the first word. Inna Allah ya'muru bil adl. Al adl, to be just. Allah orders us to be just. Just with, first, you fulfill the rights upon you towards Allah Azza wa Jal. You fulfill the rights upon you towards your parents, towards your wife and children, towards your neighbors. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in the hadith that Jibreel, angel Jibreel, kept on urging me about the neighbor, meaning to look after the neighbor. He urged me to look after the neighbor to an extent that I thought he's going to tell me he might be entitled to inherit me after my death. To what extent he was emphasizing the rights of the neighbor. There are rights that many people do not think about. If you are living in units style, let us say, and you start beating something, let us say at night after 10 o'clock, and those in the lower level will be bothered. The people do not care. So you need to take into consideration these matters. The scholar said, if you are living around people who are poor, they said, do not make what we call the barbecue. If you want to have barbecued meat, let us say, in front of them, try to hide this. Try not to make the smell reach their houses. because that will affect them, because they cannot eat meat. You need to think about these matters. So if you think about al-adl, when you give everyone all his rights. So have you asked yourself, what are the rights of my wife upon me? What are the rights of my husband upon me? What are the rights of my children upon me? What are the rights of my parents upon me? The scholar said, if you have money in excess of your basic needs, in excess of your basic needs, you have some extra money, you can perform Hajj with that money. And you have a poor father, and your mother died, and your father is in need of getting married. He needs someone to look after him. He wants a lady to live with her, continue his life. He feels that he is in need of getting married. Because the father is in need, and you have some money in excess of what covers your basic needs, then you need to help your father. You should help your father. To that extent, then you save money later to perform Hajj. But now your father has an urgent need, so you give him that need. You help him if he is in need of it. So if you want to talk about the rights, then you need to take sessions. All these are included in that word, al-adl. Inna Allah ya'muru bil-adl. Inna Allah ya'muru bil-adl. To support your Muslim brother and not to withdraw from supporting him when he is in need of your support. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that the Muslim is a brother to his Muslim. Yani the Muslims are brothers. Al-Muslim akhul Muslim. The Muslim is a brother of the other Muslim. La yazlimuhu wa la yakhzuluhu. La yazlimuhu, he doesn't wrong him, doesn't treat him unjustly. وَلَا يَخْزُلُهُ, he does not withdraw from supporting him when he is in need of that support. Sometimes, by supporting your Muslim brother, you might be able to alleviate injustice from your Muslim brother. You need to give him that support. Imagine how beautiful this society will be if all these rights are fulfilled 100%. He'll have a perfect society. But because all these rights, most of them are not fulfilled these days, you're having the troubles. You're having a high percentage of divorce between the couples because of these rights not being fulfilled. So the problem is not and was never in Islam and practicing Islam. Never. Rather, the problem is in those who are not practicing Islam. So when they do not practice the rules of the religion, that's when problems arise. So all these things are included in Al-Adl wal-Ihsan. Allah ordered us with Al-Ihsan, benevolence. Al-Ihsan is beyond justice. Meaning what is more than just what is classified as justice or the just right for your Muslim brother. You give him his right and this is justice. Give him something more on top. This is ihsan, benevolence. So not only Islam encouraged and that's ordered with al-adl, which is an obligation, al-adl. You have to give everyone his right. Islam ordered, and this is highly recommended with what? With al-ihsan, benevolence. So when dealing with your wife, give her her rights, give her something more. This is from al-ihsan. Let us say, for instance, you hear that your wife is a bit sick. If you get up and make her a cup of tea, squeeze some lemon in it, bring her this cup of tea. This is from what? From Al-Ihsan. Although you already bought the food for her, let us say, and they are in the fridge, but if you prepare them for her because she is sick, you show benevolence. This is Al-Ihsan. And this is higher than just being just to your wife. Same with the wife dealing with her husband. When she does more than the rights that she owes to her husband, she does something more out of benevolence. This is Al-Ihsan. You reach higher stages when you practice Al-Ihsan. So Allah ordered with Al-Adl, justice, and ordered with Al-Ihsan. It was mentioned that one of the righteous Muslims asked his female slave to bring the fire charcoals because they wanted to eat meat. So as she was bringing the fire charcoals, she tripped over and she dropped them on his child, the baby. The charcoals went through his body and he died in front of his eyes. He's her master. She started shivering. Then how can she calm down this righteous Muslim? She reminded him of the verse, وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظِ, those who control their temper. She reminded him with this portion of the ayah, وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظِ. He said, I controlled my temper. She continued the verse, وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ, those who forgive others. He said, go, I have forgiven you. She continued the ayah, وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Allah highly accepts those who are benevolent. So they do what is what? Beyond the rights. Not only the rights, even beyond. وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. He said, go, you are free for the sake of Allah. From the Quran. One ayah. She reminded him of one ayah. He controlled his temper. He forgave her and he freed her for the sake of Allah. So remember this. If you get angry with your wife, remember these three things. Remember to control your temper. Remember to forgive her if she does something wrong, because we're not perfect. And remember to be benevolent when dealing with her. And that will change the way you deal with each other. Same with a wife. When dealing with your husband, think about these three things. Control your temper, try not to get angry. If your husband doesn't like you to scream at home, try to control your temper and not to scream. Try not to have a lot of requests that are beyond your rights. And try to treat him nicely as much as you can. The husband and the wife should compete to please each other in a lawful way, seeking the rewards from Allah Azza wa Jalla. How beautiful would it be when they deal with each other based on this? Because we live an ordinary life. In our ordinary life, okay, you need to go in the morning to work. But think about, if I intend that I want to work for the sake of Allah so I can get money to support my wife and children, you will be rewarded for your work. When you buy food, you put the intention, I'm buying this food to support my wife and children, you will be rewarded for this. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam even mentioned that even when one puts the bite of food in the mouth of his wife with a good intention, he will be rewarded for it. Which is something that out of habit it could happen, but if one does it with a good intention, he will be rewarded. There are many gates for goodness. All what you need to do is just knock on them. Enter these gates filled with gates of goodness. Our religion gave you many opportunities where you can gain rewards and be a better person. So it's not a good thing like to say, yeah, I'm like this, I'm short-tempered. If one talks to me twice, I get angry. Are you proud of this? You should be ashamed of this because you are defective. This is a defect. If you have a short temper, that's a defect. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Laysa ash-shadidu man ghalaba an-nas, walakin ash-shadida man ghalaba nafsah." The strong one is not the one that beats others, defeat others. Rather, the strong one is the one that defeats himself by making sure he doesn't do what is not accepted in Islam. In another hadith, he said, "ليس الشديد بالسرعة ولكن الشديد الذي يملك نفسه عند الغضب." The strong man is not the one that knocks others down like by fight when fighting them. Rather, the strong man is the one who controls himself when angry. And that's not only for men, that's for women as well. Controlling your temper when angry. You have to be wise. So imagine dealing with each other with al-adl, not only al-adl, al-ihsan as well. Then Allah said, وَإِيْتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى. Now if you are just and you are benevolent, it's expected that you are giving the rights of your relatives as well. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned this separately to emphasize their rights. وَإِيْتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى. Now those who are related to you and are classified as arham, that you have to maintain the relationship with them, you do not sever the relationship with them, those who are called al-arham, are those who are related to you from your father's side or your mother's side. Even who are far related, but from this side or that side, they are from arham. And some of them could be marriageable to you, but Islamically they are classified as rahim. Like for a man, his paternal female cousin or maternal female cousin, he can marry her, meaning the daughter of his mom's sister or his mom's brother or his father's sister or his father's brother. So that daughter is his cousin. You say cousin in English for all of them. He can marry her. But apart from this fact, she's from ar-rahim. They have rights. So your uncles and paternal uncles and maternal uncles, your paternal aunties and maternal aunties are related to you from ar-rahim. You need to support them. Keep and maintain the relationship with them. Do not sever the ties with them. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "La yadkhulu al-jannata qati'." So literally it means the one who severs the ties won't enter paradise. But it means he won't enter paradise with the first batch that will enter paradise. Rather, he deserves to be tortured prior to being admitted to paradise. So he won't be amongst the first batch to be admitted to paradise, because severing the ties is a major sin. For that reason, the Prophet ﷺ emphasized on this matter as well. So, and in some cases, it's sufficient for you to keep ties with them, to visit them every now and then, especially in occasions where they expect you to be there. Upon a death incident, or on days of Eid, or they have a happy occasion, you might visit them, but they expect you. If you don't visit them in these occasions, what do they feel? Especially in death occasion, that you have severed the ties with them, and then that is haram, that is forbidden. If they are far away in another country, by calling them, sending them messages, stay in touch with them. So they know, yeah, he always talked to us. Now you sent a message. Let us say after 1 week, give him a call. Maybe now they have many, what you call them, means of communication. So you can communicate with them to make them feel that you have not severed the ties with them. If they are in need of money, they are in need of support financially, and you are able to help them, it becomes an obligation upon you to help them, even financially. So they have rights. For that reason, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned them to emphasize their rights. إن الله يأمر بالعدل justice والإحسان benevolence وإيتاء ذي القربى giving the rights to your relatives, from keeping ties with them to supporting them financially when they are in need and you are able, and so on. So these are the three orders. وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي. Al-Fahsha, Allah forbids us from committing Al-Fahsha. Al-Fahsha is every major sin. It's called Fahsha. And in the Quran, Allah mentioned about fornication and adultery. وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً وَسَاءَ سَبِيلًا. Do not come near fornication and adultery, because it is fahsha. Fahsha meaning abhorrent and enormous sin. It is an abhorrent and enormous sin. So al-fahsha here, وَيَنْهَا عَنِ الْفَحْشَاء, every abhorrent and enormous sin, stay away from them. وَالْمُنْكَر, al-munkar, what is forbidden in Islam? Any forbidden matter. So Allah mentioned al-fahsha, the major sins first, and while they are mentioned separately, although they are included in the word al-munkar, because al-munkar means any sin. Could be major, could be minor. This is called munkar, to show the importance of avoiding these major sins. Because the major sins are the destructive sins. When one comes near any of these major sins, he's committing major sins, even one, and he dies without repentance, he deserves to be tortured in hellfire severely for committing major sins. Allah said, فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَاهُونَ. الْوَيْل, the severe torture. Allah threatened with severe torture, those who pray after the time of the prayer is finished. So after its time is over, that's when they pray. They keep deferring, they're watching some episodes on TV, some programs, shows, whatever, watching some football games. Yeah, I'll pray after half an hour, after 15 minutes, when they put an ad, as many would do, subhanAllah. They keep deferring until the time of the prayer is over. Then they pray. So let us say it's Maghrib time, they haven't prayed on time, kept on deferring until now it's time for Isha prayer. The Isha time has set in. That's when they pray Maghrib. So they didn't pray within the designated time. For no excuse, this is a major sin. Allah threatened them with al-wail. And al-wail is the severe torture. So one type of major sins is sufficient to make one under the threat of being tortured in hellfire on the day for judgment. Of course, if he doesn't repent before death. Because some people might be taking drugs, might be drinking alcohol, might be committing other major sins, and because now they are young, they say, yeah, I'll stop later, I'll repent later. You cannot guarantee later. Later is not guaranteed. One of the scholars was in a session. Look at this, subhanAllah. And they wanted to pray in congregation. So everyone started asking the other one to lead the prayer. You pray as an imam. The other one said, no, you pray as an imam. So they were talking about this. Then one of them, and that righteous Muslim was on the side hearing. Then one of them agreed to lead them in the prayer. And he said to them, look, but if I lead you in this prayer, I'm not going to lead you in the next prayer. Find someone else. Then that righteous Muslim said to him, we seek refuge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the long hope. O oblivious person, you have chance to live till the next prayer? Are you sure, are you certain about remaining alive till the next prayer? Subhanallah, he considered this as what? A long hope. Just to think that he's going to remain alive till the next prayer. So one should think about all these things, and he shouldn't say, I'll repent later, inshallah, when I go to Hajj, I'll perform Hajj, then I'll be a good person. You might die as a bad person before becoming a good person. And just imagine now the angel of death is coming, approaching. It's coming to you to take your soul out. Just think about yourself. Are you ready? Always ask yourself this question. So if yourself tempts you to commit something haram, you do it just this time and the like, say to yourself, what about if the angel of death comes right now to take my soul out? I'll be dying as a sinner. I'll be assembled with the sinners while others are assembled with the righteous Muslims in the shade of the Arsh. I don't want to be in that situation. I don't care about this. I can survive without it. I can survive without it. You can have what you call a happy life. You can enjoy without committing haram. Don't think that enjoyment comes from haram only. When enjoyment comes from haram, the enjoyment will not last definitely. Then you'll be left with the burden of that sin. But when enjoyment comes from halal, permissible way, it will go away as well. But at least you haven't committed a sin. So think about this. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيْتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ وَالْبَغِي. Allah prohibits us from committing these three things. الفحشاء, the major sins. والمنكر, any type of sin, whether it is major or minor. وَالْبَغِي, oppression. To oppress others, to treat them unjustly, to wrong them. You know, injustice in this life will turn into darkness in the hereafter. Injustice is darkness in the hereafter. الظلم ظلمات يوم القيامة. Where you are in need on that day, on the day of judgment, for some lights, something to relieve you, something to protect you, to save you. You'll be looking at these things on the day of judgment. You'll find injustice as a patch of darkness. You don't want that to happen. For that reason, the Prophet ﷺ said, "من كان عنده لأخيه مظلمة فليتحلل منها قبل أن لا يكون دينار ولا درهم." So if there is a conflict between you and your Muslim brother, and you wronged him, then try to ask for forgiveness or give him his right back before you come on the day for judgment, and no dinar or dirham will benefit you. You cannot reimburse it, compensate it by giving dinar or dirham. You know, dinar, the golden coin, dirham, silver coin. Now it's easier than the hereafter, but some people, subhanAllah, the devil comes to them and keeps pumping them, pumping them, pumping them. They become overpumped. They explode. They become extremely arrogant, stubborn. And they would say, "Why would I need to apologize? He made me do such and such." Yeah, but he committed a sin. Let us say someone said something to you, you got upset and you bashed him. Islamically, you have committed a sin. Because even if he swore at you, you are not allowed to bash him. Because he didn't hit you. He swore at you, but he didn't hit you. So if you hit him, that means you are going beyond the limits, you are committing a sin in that case. Then after that, if you want to apologize, to ask for forgiveness and the like, you know, the devil comes to you and yourself as well. Tell you don't do it. What do you think people will say about you? Let them say what they want to say. But on the day for judgment, I don't want to have this burden of injustice on my shoulder, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. Clear yourself, free yourself of any injustice in this life before you come on the day for judgment with that burden that will turn into what? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Do you know who is a bankrupt?" The companion said, "The one who doesn't have money or wealth." He said, "No. The bankrupt is the one who comes on the day for judgment and he had committed injustice against this one. He swore at this one unjustly. He hit that one unjustly. He took the money of that one unjustly. So he comes on the day for judgment with all these burdens." So what happens on the day for judgment? He cannot say, "Okay, take from my money." Rather, they take from his rewards. That would be better for them. That would be better for them. So they take from his rewards. So by the time he is repaying everyone his rights, paying off all the rights for the injustice he committed against them, he becomes empty of rewards. The Prophet said, not only that, the Prophet said, when his rewards become empty, then for the rest, he will be given from their sins. So he takes from their sins, and that will be the compensation for what he did. Then he will be thrown into hellfire. It's way harder than in this life saying to a person, "I apologize. I shouldn't have said this. I ask you to forgive me." that doesn't make you miss your arm or one eye or one ear. Not gonna lose anything. Just you show humbleness instead of being arrogant and stubborn. So always in the hereafter is way harder than in this life. That's why think about this, brothers and sisters. Think about being free of any injustice. And remember this ayah. Memorize it. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ وَالْبَغِي. And learn. Keep coming to the religious sessions. I'm sure today some of you, and I intentionally mentioned some of the rights of the daughters towards their mums, for instance, because I know some of them are unaware of this. I mentioned some of the rights of the husband, the wife, and the like, to show that by learning, you learn about the obligations, about the rights. But without learning, you think you are perfect. This is how you see yourself. Why? Because you are not knowledgeable about these matters. It's like when you want to buy a car, for instance. If you don't have experience, ask those who have experience. He might look at the car and he thinks, wow, it's excellent. This car looks gorgeous, it doesn't have any problem. But when you bring an expert and he checks the car, he gives you a full report, maybe 5 pages. The one who knows will be able to identify the defects and the problems, but the one who doesn't have the knowledge, he won't be able to. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase our knowledge and benefit us with the knowledge we are acquiring. And Allah knows best. We say La ilaha illallah 3 times.